Good evening, everyone. I'm quasi hosting this beautiful evening tonight, and I want to first, I'm Shulamit Bruckstein, Tasweer Project, House of Tasweer, and would love to thank, first of all, ICI and Claudia Peppel and Christoph Holzhey to host us tonight in this beautiful main hall of the ICI Berlin. I love this place, and we are privileged and honored that we can be here. Thank you. Dear friends and colleagues, dear Steve, this is a very festive moment indeed, a double privilege to present the artist, thinker, writer, photographer, Steve Sabella, a son of the old city of Jerusalem, who lives and works in Berlin, whose works have been exhibited in many solo and group exhibitions in Jerusalem, in Gaza, in London, Ramallah, Verona, Dubai, Chicago, New York, Sarajevo, Beirut, and so forth. An artist whose roots are spread heavenwards, who resides in his art, who signs his book as a citizen of planet Earth, who won international prizes and scholarships in Westminster, Berlin, London, and more, including the Ellen Auerbach Award of the Berlin Academy in the Arts 2008 in Berlin. Steve Sabella published various essays and books and regularly presents at international conferences, including the TED Talk Marrakesh, where he was invited by and met the curator and writer Alya Sebti. Thank you, Alya, for coming. Yeah, who's now directing ifa-Galerie in Berlin. Thanks, Alya, for being with us. Steve Sabella's work is part of the British Museum collection, the collections of Bajil Foundation, Matraf Arab Museum of Modern Art in Doha, the Museum of Contemporary Arab Art in Beirut, and so forth. The film we are screening tonight, In the Darkroom with Steve Sabella, has been shown in independent film festivals around the world. A double privilege it is, as we do not only celebrate the presence of the artist, but also that of his latest work, The Parachute Paradox. It is an artist book of a very special kind, a mesmerizing life story, beautifully crafted and designed by the bookmaker Verena Galach. She's here. Thank you, Verena, for being here. It's really, really beautiful. Together, we want to speak about this gorgeous black book, a book about home, about Jerusalem, about the effects and after effects of the occupation, the occupation of Palestine, of the self, of Jerusalem, about the hijacking of tradition, the hijacking of the image, even the image of Jerusalem, and most importantly, about what the artist calls the colonization of the artistic imagination. This meticulously produced book is about exile, not only that of the artist, but even of Jerusalem, the city of prophets, who so miserably betrays her promise to act as a secure haven for all its citizens. It is a book about the artist's exiled mother tongue, about alienated speech and failed communications, about exiled dreams, and most disturbingly, about the haunting experience of the protagonist's imagination being locked in by the politics of separation, by the constant violations of human rights, simply put, by the conditions of the dictated occupation. One of the liberating features of the Parachute Paradox is the fact that it starts off with a very simple presumption. Just as there's no question about rape being unjust, so there's no question that living under occupation cripples life. I am not pro-Palestinian, I'm pro-justice. These words by the political thinker and philosopher Norman Finkelstein are so naturally endorsed by the artist that any pros and cons about whose side anyone is on seem redundant and are of no concern to the book. The question of the parachute paradox is rather how to break free, how to rescue the artistic imagination and indeed the author's life from the grip of its colonizers. In a brilliant dramaturgic move, the author Steve Sabella, in the end, does find a way to break free from the fate of his protagonist, inspired and supported by precious literary and real-life collaborators. Most importantly, his love, Francesca. Francesca's here. It's wonderful to see you. And his daughter, Celine. She's also here. And a precious handful of his closest artist friends, some of whom are world-renowned, who honor this space very often with their presence, such as Kamal Bulata with Lily Farhood and more. Revealing the stunning gaze of the author for his protagonist, who remains entrapped in the Kafkaesque maze of identity and separation systems, The Parachute Paradox is also a book about liberation, freedom, and return. The artist Steve Sabella, in a leap of trust, drives the parachute metaphor to an even more radical edge than previously announced, I think. He breaks his protagonist free from the shackles of body and mind and from his caged-in mirror image. With breathtaking courage, razor-sharp self-inspection, and relentless artistic energy, the author takes it up with his shadow, producing ever new artworks unto which he delegates the burdens of exile. Each one of these works tackles a hazardous, dangerous problem by turning moments of paralysis into visual dilemmas. Steve Sabella's work has the power to rescue occupied visual codes. In his escape to freedom, the artist draws deeply from the power of the poetic and visual imagination. He takes the entire world and its reality to be an imagination within the imagination, a dream within a dream, just like the 13th century mystical writers of Al-Andalus, Damascus, Konya, and more, who find a passionate re-endorsement in Steve Sabella's life story of the Parachute Paradox. The Parachute Paradox is therefore also a book about the transformation of the self and about the power of love. Steve Sabella creates windows of exile in his art, faithful to Jerusalem as the eternal capital of the artistic imagination. How does he do it? How do exiled Jerusalemites from Palestine who live in Berlin build new Jerusalems in their work, in their art? What are the techniques of opening windows of exile in their mind? We are about to watch the film, Steve Sabella in the Darkroom. The film contains passages about Steve Sabella's work, 38 Days of Recollection. For this work, the artist went back to the houses of his childhood in the old city of Jerusalem. In a dazzling inversion of exile, he sets out to physically remove, recover, and reclaim layer after layer of the old houses' inner and outer walls, collecting fragile decomposition fragments in order to then re-imprint on them in a special photo technique images of his own. Images he collected in Jerusalem when visiting, not long ago, as an international artist whose Palestinian identity became fluid in the neighborhood in Karem that was claimed and inhabited after 49 by Israelis. In this very personal Jerusalem project, Steve Sabella works himself physically through layers and layers of the old city of his childhood, layers of paint, layers of life, layers of memory, and layers of injuries, in order to quite materially take down, invert, and reverse the occupation. Steve Sabella literally inscribes his own specific law of return onto this work. During the next few minutes, we will watch the film Steve Sabella in the Darkroom. Now I'm coming to the order of the evening. We will speak among the three of us loosely in a kind of artist talk here. And I invite the audience, since we're an intimate audience, to interrupt us and don't forget to take the micro, what I was told. We will hear Steve Sabella read selected passages from his work, and we will leave more room for all your questions in the end. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you for your time, Terry. Thank you for sharing this moment with us. Thank you to both of you for this wonderful invitation. And as you were mentioning before, Shulen, now we will have like more loose conversations. So it's more trying to dig into your world, another part of your world. It's you have been like aside from your visual artist, you have been writing also extensively. You have been writing on contemporary art practices. You have been writing on the artist curse in 2014. But can you share with us how did the idea start? What was like this moment that made you think, okay, now I'm going for this, the parachute paradox. I'm going to dedicate this whole part of my life to dig into not only like you're not only protected behind the whole the visual language. It's really, on the one hand, you have your autobiography. On the other hand, you're mixing it with your practice, with your understanding of also of life when you're talking about how you're dealing with imagination, with identity, with images. But yeah, how did it start? Let's start from the scratch. How did it start?
Hi. Thank you everyone for coming. I'm honored by everyone here, and I have my list of thank you. Maybe I'll do it maybe towards the end just to keep us flowing for now. It started probably 20 years ago when I met Francesca, who is sitting right here, and she's the main character in my book. And later, Cici, my daughter, becomes another great character in my life. I wanted to write this book 21 years ago, when I was really 20. When I met Francesca, I told her, listen, I have a book in my mind, and I want to write it. But it seems I needed to go dig into image theory, image making first for many, many years, understand what I'm looking at, the world we live in. And when I started getting it or penetrating image codes, I felt probably liberated in 2012, and I felt that was the right time now to take words and let words be transformed into images. I felt ready. So I started, I took my pen or I opened my laptop and I wrote my first sentence in November 2012. I thought, piece of cake. 3 months, I'm done. It turned out it took more than 3 years of really stitching wounds. I couldn't move forward. I had to believe in every word I have written. I had to believe in every paragraph, in every chapter. I only moved forward when I felt I came to terms with the files of my past. I opened them one by one. And at the same time, I was reading Willem Flusser, came to my life, the philosopher, he said, exilees come to terms with their homeland, not when they deny their homeland, they come to terms with their exile, not when they deny their homeland, but when they come to terms with it. So I came to terms with where I come from. I'm 100% proud of where I come from. And I come from the old city of Jerusalem, and to be precise, from a neighborhood called Bab Hotta, which back then, which you will read in the book, I might have been embarrassed of where I come from. But today I endorse it because you cannot deny where you come from. It's part of my identity. It will always be part of me. And many people think freedom is forgetting. No, freedom is not forgetting. It's about coming to terms with the self. So 3 years, I had to stitch my wounds. Probably I used the quote in the book with barbed wire. And you can imagine the pain of stitching the wounds with barbed wire. My skin became very thick. So today it's very hard that politics or exile or occupation to really influence me. I feel way stronger than all these notions.
When I look at my phone, it's just because I have some notes from the book there.
Feel free to text.
Because you were mentioning the part on identity, and in the book there is, at some point you were saying, my task was not to find my identity, but to get rid of it.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
And also, like, how do you position it yourself also with the identity and more freedom, and the identities that you have embraced, also all the places where that you have been, the people that you have encountered?
Yeah, it's funny. I was hoping Kamal Bulata would be here tonight. He once gave me a book, and there's a nice quote in the book. It says, hermits go to the desert not to find their identity, but to lose it. I was aware of that process. Many people assume that monks go to stress on their identity. It's actually the opposite. They go there to forget or to let go or to process a new form of identity. For me, identity has always been fluid. I really feel from the day I was born, identity was fluid for me. I mean, what is identity? It's a process. It has to change every day. There is no way on earth, you know, the light that drops on us right now is changing every second. So how can we be the same tomorrow? So I felt my identity is shaped by the things I read, by life. And I have to adjust to life. And I can feel however I want to feel. It's a feeling that it's not a label. It's not you're a Palestinian, you're Israeli. You can be whatever you want to be. It's fine. I can be all of them and none of them at the same time. Okay? That's why I think identity is fluid. And just recently, I've been watching a program. Scientifically speaking, this has been proven, that identity is actually a construct, and it's more fluid than you can ever imagine. Now, it's a choice. How do you want to live your life? Do you want to live it as a label or as a river, flowing, changing, going with the energy of life? And I feel going with the energy of life is way more nicer to the self than being reminded every day of who you are. And now, why I'm thinking like this? Because if you live in Jerusalem, I'm sure you don't know this, but as a Palestinian, you are stopped non-stop by Israeli soldiers, even the same soldier, like 10 times a day. It's almost like a decision to make sure to remind you of who you are and what you are every day. I say to the extent that my brother, Paul, he wanted to glue his ID on his forehead while walking the old city, because enough is enough, right? Anyway, let's move on.
This was also a question I had, really, because Jerusalem is a city where identity, people come to Jerusalem, we call it the Jerusalem syndrome, because of identity issues. You have people who really want to find their identity, look for their sources, and go to the Via Dolorosa to find their own identity. So the entire separation system is built on identities. What's your name? Why is your name Steve? Why it doesn't sound Arabic, etc.
And religion.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. So the kind of you're turning it into this idea of getting rid of it is really one of the strategies I found so convincing in the book. And I think the title, the very title, that would be my question, The Parachute Paradox, is really a title which you explain in a way by someone sort of staying on top and controlling the grip on the one who's jumping. And I would like to hear a bit more about it. And I think there might be something you yourself do in the book, towards the end of the book, which gives it an even much more radical taste, really. The Parachute Paradox, which you also sort of created with the Magen David on it. No?
It's not illustration one-to-one. It's another project. It's from the same spirit, but it's not translating the title.
Never mind the Magen David. It's just the idea that the Israeli controls, and also beyond the physical space, actually the imagination, even if you're in London or Berlin or wherever. Yeah. But there's some interesting idea, I think, about the parachute paradox. But the paradox really is that in the end, you actually did disentangle yourself.
Yeah.
You did disentangle yourself, and actually you were jumping, and you freed yourself from this grip. So this title of the book could actually be sort of a double title.
Yeah.
Yes? And you see what I mean?
I see what you mean. It's like the para-para even.
Yes,
you know,
it's the parachute paradox.
The previous name of the book was The Artist's Curse. Mm-hmm. I was so fixed to this name that there is no way on earth I want to change it. Almost fixed on biblical stone. Mm-hmm. But then I realized, if you really speak of freedom, you can't be fixed to anything. So when I was writing the story about Gaza, this is how we go to the title. They tell you Gaza is freed, correct? Yes, 100%. They left, the army went and outside to control it from the sides. Everything is in control in Gaza, from A to Z. There is not one thing, not even a headache pill, that enters Gaza without Israeli control. Yet the propaganda that is being sold to the world, that we left Gaza and they're still throwing rockets at us. Here I have another issue. The conflict between Israelis and Palestinians is always about the side effects. Nobody speaks about the core issue. Yeah. It's like as if the rockets stop, there will be peace. If Israel stops settlements, there will be peace, and X, Y, Z. These are all side effects, bandages to the problem. You want to solve the problem, go to the core. And the core is, let's go back to 1948, and you know what, even before 1948, to the Holocaust, and before the Holocaust, all this movement that went into Jerusalem. So why I use the metaphor of the parachute, am I heard fine, all good? Why I'm using the metaphor of the parachute? Because you are in the air. You're supposed to feel free, 100%. I mean, who doesn't like to feel free and jumping from the air? And that's the situation we are being told in Gaza, we left them. But are they really free? Are they really living in freedom? Of course not, because there is an Israeli on the back of every Palestinian on Gaza, right? And that is, the freedom is an illusion. Like me jumping with the Israeli on my back is an illusion that I'm actually having a great time on my own. It's up to the Israeli to decide if I will survive or not. All he has to do, unbuckle me and I'm dead. So what choices do I have being in the air? Of course, you might see in the book that I might become a suicide bomber. You know, explode the hell out of him and me. But do I look to you like somebody, I want to kill anyone? Do I look to you like I want to die? Of course not. I embrace life. I don't want to kill anyone. So there is another way out. And this way out, it has to do with the imagination. Now, here I realized, long time ago, but you know, over the years I became clear about it. The occupation of the land is given. But Israelis do not only occupy the land. They occupy the minds of people. They control their imagination. Palestinians have reached to the point where they can no longer imagine to live in freedom. And if they can no longer imagine to live in freedom, how does anyone expect them to liberate the land? So here the process became about the liberation of the self. The only dilemma is not many people are aware of this colonization of the mind and how to deal with it. Somebody asked me in my last book launch in Kuwait, for example, yeah, why you only give two ways for your exit? I said, listen, there are a million other ways. I give you two. You can find a million others. The solution I give is true to myself. But feel free to project your own imagination. So in many ways, to be brief, the book aims at bringing back agency to the individual. And once the individual is liberated, that individual can inspire others. And then you have a movement. That's how it starts. When I got home, I raced against time to park and get to Ben Gurion Airport in Tel Aviv. I was exhausted and dreaded the usual 3 hours of questioning and interrogation by Israeli airport security. Shalom, meyefo ata? Hello, where are you from? In a Hebrew accent, while gargling the L in Yerushalayim, I said, Ani ba meYerushalayim, I come from Jerusalem. She continued, where exactly do you come from? If I answered with East Jerusalem, it would be assumed I was an Arab. And if I answered with West Jerusalem, it would be assumed I was Jewish. I replied, Antonia Street, Old City. She checked my passport, but my place of origin was still not clear to her. She asked me for my father's name, Emil, your mother's, Esperance. Your grandfather's, Anton. What is the origin of the name Sabella? Italian. Do you celebrate Hanukkah? Why not? Do you celebrate Christmas? Sure. She was hesitant to ask if I was an Arab or Palestinian Arab. To speed things up, I told her I came from Jerusalem, the Arab one. All I wanted was to board the plane and close my eyes. What is your occupation? Artist. I also work for the UN as a photographer. I showed her my press card. Where were you before you arrived at the airport? I couldn't tell her I had just been kidnapped in Gaza. She would consider it a security threat and definitely not allow me to board the plane in Jerusalem. And why are you going to Switzerland? To have a holiday with my wife and daughter. My wife is Swiss. Why are you traveling alone? Why do you work with the UN? Have you traveled to Gaza with the UN? Why do you live in Jerusalem? Why don't you live in Switzerland? When did your family settle in Jerusalem? Why is your name Steve? The questions were endless, and the first security guard was replaced by a second, and the second by a third, until the chief of security was called. I kept repeating the same narrative again and again. I had to be consistent and not make any mistakes. Listen to me. This is my story. No matter how long you interrogate me, it will not change. Either you let me go home to Jerusalem, or you let me board the flight. Let's get it over with. They gave in, allowed me to board after a conspicuous bag check and a full body search, escorted me to the plane like a VIP, and finally left me. I found my seat, sat down, and leaned back to close my eyes for the first time in 2 days. But every time I heard the click of a seatbelt, I woke up startled. It sounded like the cocking of the kidnappers' guns. I opened my restless eyes and spotted a man watching me. He was black. And I imagined for a moment he was the man the kidnappers released that morning. When he noticed that I spotted him, he unbuckled the seatbelt, walked over, and sat down on the aisle seat next to me. He spread open a newspaper and pointed to a photograph. Is this you? It showed a woman and me with guns all around us, and the bold title read, UN workers freed in Gaza. I burst into laughter and said, sometimes the answer is right there in front of you. Up in the air, I traveled to the time I went skydiving in Haifa. On the tarmac, the plane looked like it hadn't flown since the 1967 war. After takeoff, the engine roared as if it could fail any second, shaking wildly as it reached the sky. When the time came, I unbuckled my seatbelt and leaned out of the open door against the strong wind. Without much thought, I did it. I let go. I was flying in the air. I felt light, less burdened by what was happening below. I felt identityless, free from all the labels and classifications, free from all the racism and discrimination, free from the Israeli occupation I was born into. But there is always a but. I didn't open the parachute. I was in a tandem jump attached to an Israeli. Over the years, I have come to see this situation in the air as a metaphor for what it means to be a Palestinian living under Israeli occupation. Life under occupation is like the reality of a Palestinian attached to an Israeli in a tandem jump. There is an Israeli on the back of every Palestinian, controlling all aspects of life. The Israeli is always in control. This impossible reality places the Palestinian under constant threat in a never-ending hostage situation. On the ground, I struggled with paralyzing depression that sank to new lows year after year. But I knew my journey would have to be one of self-interrogation and liberation. With the speed of the fall, I felt Francesca's presence. Over the years, we had built our own world based only on our imagination. Only there were we able to find our own freedom.
I mean, this scene at the airport returns. I mean, there's a loop in the book about this scene. It comes back and keeps coming back. And in the end, there's a certain twist, you know, when you come to the airport at the very end of the book. So what I find interesting, when Paul Celan actually in 1960 got the Georg Büchner Prize, he talked about the technique of crossing a border and what you do if you actually don't belong to the group. And he called it the question of the shibboleth. So the shibboleth is actually the password you need, or the kind of code. And sometimes it's a physical code. It can be a bodily code. And what I found so impressive in your book is the way you sort of describe this technique of the shibboleth at the checkpoints, the barbed, the borders, etc., and the way you actually sort of notice within yourself how you actually make the Palestinian, Arab, the Christian, Palestinian, Arab invisible, and the kind of technique of making oneself invisible
of
in one's own
survival.
Yes, it's a matter of survival. This is what Silan describes, and it's interesting that it was once a Jewish question.
Yeah.
It's no longer a Jewish question. It became a Palestinian question in.
Or the Palestinians are becoming the Jews of the 21st century, as being said, ironically. Ironically.
And it's not, it's ironically, and it's really something that is, it's really some serious question to think about. Yeah? The Palestinian in, of all places, in Israel, in occupied Palestine, becoming the Jew of the later part of the 20th century. But maybe speak a bit about it, because it's a matter of accent, it's a matter how you walk, the speed you walk in, the gaze you maybe you speak a
the
bit
thing
about
is,
that.
In Jerusalem, I always wanted to be myself. The last thing that the city allows you is to be yourself. You know, we have a dilemma there. So in the book, you will see there's a section where I lived invisibly among Israeli society, where they assumed I'm an Israeli or a Jew that who came from Europe, immigrated to the land. That was their perception. I didn't correct them because it's not my job to correct people's perception. There is, I tell you what the problem is. Palestinians suffer from a problem and Israelis suffer from another problem, and they're interconnected. The Palestinian problem is inferiority complex. The Israelis have a superiority complex. So how do you deal in a situation where this side feels inferior and this side feels superior? If you live in Israel, you would probably, and if there are Israelis among us, they might agree with me, they tend to feel that they are better than anyone else. They are better than Edward, and the average Israeli boy, he thinks better than Edward Said. You know? Like, who is Edward Said to him? Like, he's a nobody. And this is a notion that is felt all over. Now, I never felt inferior. How can I feel inferior? I feel equal to everyone else on this planet. We're all born the same. So how is it happening that some nations, other people feel superior to others? And we live in a land that we know from the past what happened here. And when this happens, there is always a clash, because this is universal truth. We are all born free and equal, at least as the way I see it, okay?
Another thing is that, of course, from the perspective of the average Israeli, the separation apartheid wall doesn't, in a way, exist because it's hidden from their view.
It's built
so
on Palestine.
They have a kind of feeling, if you live in Tel Aviv or in West Jerusalem, that there is no wall. It's absurd, but you never see the wall.
Yeah.
And the children grow up and they know that some might even not know that there is a wall. And it's a very radical, a distance in terms of the daily experience. So
Israelis hardly meet any Palestinians, believe it or not. I mean, in my project, Settlement, 6 Israelis and 1 Palestinian, one of the guys I spoke with, an academic even, he said, the first time I speak to Palestinian was with you in London. I mean, he lived 33 years in Tel Aviv. He never had any communication channel with any Palestinian. Now, how is this possible? There are 6 million Palestinians on the land, and they are invisible to the Israeli eye. The separation wall, when it was built, the Israeli army painted on the outside brown with the color of the land, so that when the Israeli drives, it melts, with the landscape. How beautiful, Or they put in it tiles so that you think it's a nice stone wall from the Israeli side, but you go from the Palestinian side, it's 8 to 9 meters high. Every horizon of every Palestinian village or city starts or ends with the separation wall. That's something to think about, because does the wall solve a problem? Again, that's a side effect. The wall can never solve a problem. You need to go back to the core. And again, the core, we have to go way back.
I'm saying this not to put a finger on anyone, but to actually thematize what you named the diasporic kind of thinking, because this thinking, like in exile, is a crossing of borders that today became the virtue of those who are actually escaping the borders. And the ones who are actually within the borders, proud citizens maybe of the state, they actually have this imagined idea that they're global citizens, but they're not in fact, because they sort of built a kind of ghetto, which hasn't been there in the Jewish history but it's a kind of enclosed reality that makes believe that you actually can be cosmopolitan. But in fact, the virtues of exile have long abandoned the Jews. Right? So this is what, when one reads your work, is it's very clear that the crossing of boundaries became the virtue of the Palestinian artist.
Yeah. As I want to say, there are many things to speak about. By any means, I'm not pro-Palestine, as you said. I'm not anti-Israel, for sure, okay? I am pro-justice, but how do I claim I'm pro-justice? I had to uproot myself. Imagine, from my old city roots, I felt a refugee at home. I felt really in exile living in Jerusalem to the extent that I felt the city itself is an image. So if Jerusalem is an image, so what in the name of heavens did the Jews return to? The physical place hardly exists. It's a construct of the imagination. The Jerusalem that the Jewish people speak about is an image from the past. No, I'm not denying the Jews a homeland. I want to be clear about this. I think Jews, just like everyone else, like every Palestinian, belong to live on every spot on planet Earth. This is their true place for everyone.
There's a beautiful passage which I would love to read. Please. When you met Micha Ullmann, who was very, very famous of course in Berlin because he put up so many interesting works on memory, the Bibelplatz and the library and now the Mendelssohn Memorial. So when you talk to Micha Ullmann, there's a conversation that's recorded in the book that I would love to read. It's a few paid sentences. Israeli Jews wrongly assume that they've returned to Jerusalem. When the Jews were forced into exile 2,000 years ago, they took Jerusalem with them in the form of a mental image. It was a promise, actually. This image has escorted them through time. The Jerusalem that Jews want to return to today is no longer the same Jerusalem of the past. It was forced into exile as well. And we can talk about what this exile of Jerusalem is from the Jewish perspective. How could Jews feel at home when what they returned to was merely an image, an imagined place constructed by religious ideologies and political ideologies, by media, by Israeli government-issued Aliyah brochures, encouraging immigration? In practice, the Jewish claim of having returned to the homeland is an illusion. The fact is, all Jews are still in exile. And I would say, I mean, radicalizing this, I think Jews have lost the virtue of exile. So I would disagree with you on this, only on this last thing, that the Jew no longer lives in exile because this, the national's claim of a territory which is defended by military force, even if it would be, if it would not be an unjust system, just imagine it would be a just kind of system. It's still a territory that actually ruins the tradition of imagining Jerusalem to be the promised haven for all its citizens, or even the inhabitants of the earth. So it's a very strong paragraph.
To be honest, I wanted to go more deep into this, but the book also has its own number, its own limits, let's say, like everything in life. You know, you don't finish something,
and
you just abandon
it. It's a disaster.
It is a disaster, in my opinion, because if I would be a Jew, and maybe there's a Jew in all of us, who knows, I would never feel okay to be again ghettoized, you know, on a piece of land and become an easy target. I would feel very insecure, to be honest. Okay,
it's a disaster, not only politically, it's a disaster because of the tradition.
Yeah.
Because the Jewish tradition really has been inspiring in terms of its de-territorialized structure. It was a diaspora kind of thinking. And it's being sort of contained in this defensive.
Yeah, also the Israeli Jews, you know, let's just put it this way, they don't think on their own. I mean, if I want, let's say, I hope that Palestinians can free their imagination, also the Jewish nation living in Israel is being bombarded with a system that's telling it how to think, how to feel, how to imagine. There are hardly any free thinkers left in Israel that go beyond what they're being taught systematically from kindergarten.
I would like to go on a complete different topic.
Please.
Which is one of the strategies that you use to mostly creating bridges in between the borders, and it's the languages. The languages that you use, very often we see in the book that you would respond with one specific language. You would choose that language that you would translate all the time. So there are the languages. There is the accent that is also perfect. And then there is the part of, because you would speak so perfectly one language, you are seen as the Palestinian light also. Which is an image which is, it's very funny.
Like Coca-Cola light, you mean? Palestinian light as Coca-Cola light. Not like a Palestinian with a low dose of ideology. This is what an Israeli told me.
Oh, that's for sure.
That's what I've been told in London by an Israeli. Mimi, thanks for bringing that point. Funny, because I have met so many Israelis in my life. I lived in Jerusalem, so all my life was centered around, you know, Israeli society. I've never met an Israeli who did not justify the occupation. They all justify the occupation. There is always a but. You know, the security, the suicide bombers, this and that. But in London, I was in dialogue, natural dialogue with Israelis when I lived in London for 3 years. I was happy to be in dialogue with Israelis on a normal level. And then I realized, one Israeli tells me, ah, Steve, come on, you know what we call people like you? I said, what do you call people like me? He said, Palestinian light. I said, wow, Palestinian light. And then he said, no, I mean Coca-Cola light. And then I asked him, why? Is it because I'm speaking with you that suddenly you think I'm a better or different Palestinian than the Palestinian that you have in your mind? So what is the Palestinian image in his mind? Then you tend to think the only Palestinians they know are the Palestinians they get killed, or the Palestinians who were hatta from, I don't know, those Palestinians from which I respect, you know, from, you know, the peasants or whatever. They are part of the Palestinian society, but these are the only Palestinians the Israelis choose to see. I choose to look at life from multiple angles. In the same way, I know many of the Israelis I meet are probably justifying the occupation, but I still give people a chance to say their mind without judgment per se. But I feel I'm constantly being judged on certain views or on identity or on ideology or on such issues.
You want to read another passage?
Maybe I should read. That's my thing. I never know when to shut up. Okay. Oh, here you go. Speaking of this, in Jerusalem, each person lives within fixed categories. I was labeled the Christian, the Arab, the Palestinian, and I could live with all three, but these labels have never really defined who I am. I struggled to fit in when the majority of people lived in a different time and with a faith contaminated by political ideology. In Jerusalem, I sailed and navigated between religious stories to avoid becoming locked into others' visions. I realized my task was not to find my identity, but to get rid of it. I wanted an identity of my own, embroidered with my own life philosophy and stitched with my own threads. What is identity? It cannot be defined by words on paper, and words on paper never defined mine. My true identity was made of my personal views and thoughts about life, nurtured by observing its details. I never saw my identity as a label, but as a process, fluid, changing every day. Maybe this explained why I struggled when people asked me where I came from, expecting a direct answer relating to a geographic location. I wanted my answer to be true to what I felt, but in the process of not referring to labels, I became a stranger to myself, finding it difficult to relate to identity with words. The grapevine tree, we had a nice old city house, very big, many, many rooms, many courtyards, and we had two great trees, a lemon tree and a vine tree. The lemon tree really is quite something, I'll speak about it now, and the grape next to it was a grapevine tree. The grapevine tree grew from a thick trunk that split into two long branches. One extended to an upper terrace, and the other grew toward the terrace on the opposite side of the house. The grapevine shared barely 1 square meter of soil with the lemon tree. These two trees looked ancient, but every year they produced clusters of grapes and grapefruit-sized lemons. In springtime, the neighborhood air became infused with the fragrance of the lemon blossoms. I loved the lemon tree, how it flourished in the center of the house and was able to survive in hardly any soil. I assumed the lemon tree survived because its roots grew deep into the ground, so deep they might have reached the water of our deserted house well. I was often too scared to look into the well to see how far it descended into its own darkness. But once I did shine a flashlight in, its shaft looked endless, and its stone walls were covered by a mesh of roots, some of them protruding into the air. The roots never reached the water and seemed to absorb the humidity in the air. I developed a connection with the lemon tree and became its caretaker. Once, my brothers and I accidentally bruised its trunk. I turned to Mother Veronica, a relative of my mother's who had been confined to live in a Russian Orthodox monastery at the age of 5. She soon decided to become a nun and has lived there ever since. Her hobby was gardening, and the convent allocated Veronica a piece of land where I often helped her plow soil and plant flowers. She explained to me, take from its soil, make mud with water, and then plaster the wood.
Another thing which is really beautiful about the loose or fluid identity is the figures, Veronica, the Russian Orthodox, and this Michos, right? Yes. The Greek Orthodox in the neighborhood. It's all sorts of Christian colors that we don't know.
Or Jewish, I also refer to Yermi, Zenaton, or anyone, people.
Exactly, yes. So I lost my thread. I
wanted to say on this one, there is actually I follow on your thread. You will see there will be a connection. There is a very, very funny phrase in the book, and it's if you want to change the world, start with your underwear.
Yes.
There is a connection with the matter of identity and individuality, but that would be fantastic if you can explain it.
Yeah.
When I did the project with Israelis, I asked 6 Israelis who served in the Israeli army to do my project to strip to their underwear, and I did this too. I mean, if they strip, I have to strip. If I have my freedom, then Francesca has her own freedom. It's a two-way system. You can't ask someone without mirroring back. And I asked the Israelis to strip again, to mirror the journey that we need to go back and speak about the core issues.
And I mean, it's also a response to every checkpoint where Palestinians are asked strip. They have to show that they are not murderers.
Exactly.
So every single one. And this procedure, it's very funny
for
passages when you actually refuse. And then the stripping the 6 Israelis is a very interesting strategy of a subversive kind of resistance, I think.
Let's be true. I mean, Palestinians do often refer to the people, the Jews. And I defy that notion. I'm not happy with it, because Jews are also individuals. We have to look at them as people one by one. And in the exhibition, which you might have seen here, they're all standing alone, and there's a few centimeters difference, space between the images, and that's very important for me. I chose 6 to mirror many things. Again, maybe I might have resorted to semiotics, but on purpose, to let people question why 6 Israelis. And the number, I'm sure, can trigger many things in your mind, historical-wise and today, demography-wise. And on the other hand, the Israelis always are afraid from that one Palestinian who's gonna blow himself up or herself up and destroy the peace process, which actually never existed, you know? The peace process has always been an illusion, a joke sold to Israelis and Palestinians, and like a flock of sheep, we all followed this dream of having this peace. I remember 1980s, the process itself, and then the misleading and the fake Oslo Peace Accord that led to disaster, and look where we are today. I mean, if that process was genuine, today we'd be actually living in peace, but obviously it's not. It was never meant to finish the dilemma, let's just put it this way.
I mean, one of the strong sides of the book, I think, is to go very deeply into the life of the artist, and to understand that there's no pro and con.
Yes,
I found very, very interesting.
So one can not only politics.
So the political is not really sort of the most exciting here,
yeah,
I think.
Yeah.
And what I do think is exciting is the story, for example, for this Judah, if you speak of identity, I'm a Hamburgian and a Jerusalemite in a way. I lived there for 25 years. And I came there just the contrary. I mean, I came there because of an identity problem. Yeah, I sort of lost my Jewish identity, and I wanted to find it again in Jerusalem. So it's a kind of interesting for me, of course, to read this, because it's sort of it's exactly the reverse story. And what I found beautiful when you describe how you met Judah, Yehuda, or
yes,
whatever.
Yes, Yehuda, yeah.
Yeah, Yehuda in Kikar Tzion.
The drum player.
And the drum player.
Yeah.
And there's a drum player who you refer to as the Moroccan drum player, who you refer to as the Arab Orthodox Jew. It's beautiful because we have forgotten that there are Arab Orthodox Jews. And you also mentioned that there are no longer really Arab Orthodox Jews who claim that they are Arab Orthodox Jews. And the way, maybe you can tell the story to the audience, because it's beautiful, the way you drum together and you have this concert, like street scene.
When I was
scene.
18,
yes.
Before I met Francesca, when I was 20, I used to go to Jaffa Street. Jaffa Street is minutes away from the old city. And you can see it as the buffer zone, you know, where this is what is called West Jerusalem, and this is what is called East Jerusalem. But you know what? When you grow in a city like Jerusalem, I never saw it as East or West. Mm-hmm. For me, I come from Jerusalem. And this division is, as the way I see it, is wrong. In the same way, like East Berlin and West Berlin, it's Berlin. Like, I don't want to criticize the notion, but you can see what I'm talking about. It's nice to say I come from Berlin, not East or West. Because once you say East, you're already classifying, categorizing. So I always came from Jerusalem, and I thought it's 100% natural to mingle whatever you want to mingle in Jerusalem. So in brief, I want to go to the story of Yehuda. I can eat anywhere I want in Jerusalem. There, the idea of boycotting Israeli products or restaurants, I think is bullshit. Because Palestinians, this is in particular, they need to go wherever they want to go. And if there is something the Israeli hates, is to see a Palestinian in an Israeli restaurant or an Israeli area. They get spit at, they get hit, they get arrested. Even if you complain, like an Israeli hit you, you get arrested for being an Arab. You know, just like that. It's atrocious. But anyway, you know, I learned, you know, through the years. When I was 18, I met Yehuda. I was so fascinated with this guy. He's such a good drummer. And you know, drumming is in my blood. I'm also maybe a musician, you know. I'm one day I'm gonna do my own music. So I took my drum, I said, Yehuda, shalom, you know, do you mind if we just play together?
Steve, I think I've seen you, both of you.
No way.
Yes, I think, because I passed the calcium, and there were these two wonderful men drumming.
I won't really be surprised. I told him, can I play with you? And you know, I have a musical ear, I come from a musical family. I immediately, on the spot, we were in sync, like, you can't believe, you think that we have been rehearsing for months. We gathered huge crowds. We made a lot of money. And we divided it 50-50. And you said, you know what, let's do it every Saturday. Yehuda, of course, why not, you know? So Yehuda knew where I come from. I wouldn't lie, you know, I come from the old city. And who lives in the old city? It's mainly, you know, Palestinians. With a little, you know, with the Jewish minority there. But you know, I think after maybe four or five times, one time playing, and three or four Israeli soldiers come on the spot, and they take me. I said, what's the story, you know? He said, Tavoyitano, you come with me. I said, why? Because, you know, they discovered that I'm Palestinian, Arab, and of course, ID check, you know? And then I look at Yehuda, and Yehuda, tell them something, you know, because we're friends. And Yehuda, what he did, just turned his head away. I mean, are you fucking kidding me? You know? It taught me a lot. I mean, what is this story? So I saw it as betrayal in many ways. And for what? For what? For ideology? For the love of God, you're also an Arab. Are you embarrassed, ashamed of who you are? I mean, but anyway, this is another story for Arab Jews, you know, in Israel.
It's very, yeah.
I'm not going to get into it, but...
And this spring, there was this first, at the Arsenal, the Al Film Festival. I don't know if someone of you knows it. It's really wonderful. It's a few years already. And at Arsenal, the last theme was Arab-Jewish films.
Yeah.
Like, don't forget Baghdad. Like, films like Jews in Baghdad, Jews in Cairo, etc. And there were five filmmakers and the wonderful film theoretician Ella Shohat.
Yeah.
And it was very interesting that after a while one realized that the Arab-Jew actually preserves something of, the virtues of the diaspora Jew. Because, of course, the European Jew has so closely aligned himself or herself with the West that in the 19th century, still, the Jew here in Germany was Oriental. The Jew was rejected because it was a kind of Oriental, strange foreign figure. So it's actually the Arab Jew or the Jewish Arab like identity which takes and preserves something of that virtue and that future of Jewish identity in terms of the free or open-minded or cosmopolitan, whatever, agenda. And it's very interesting how there's a comeback. And there are Jews going back from Israel to Morocco. There are Jews going back to Cairo, Jews going back even to Baghdad. It's very, very interesting that there's a reclaiming of the diaspora for maybe some 20 years. Istanbul, people go back.
I wanted maybe to say before, and when you live in a place like this, what choices do you have? And I decided to uproot myself with all the pain that this entails. I mean, who likes to uproot himself or herself from their own cities of birth? To reach to the point when you go back, I travel, I can't stand the place, you know? Not because I hate Jerusalem. I mean, Jerusalem is in the heart. But you can't live with a society. And I can also speak about both sides, where it's constantly questioning your identity, who you are and what you are. So I took my roots from the ground. I planted them in the air, in the clouds. And why in the clouds? Because the clouds are always moving in transition. And this way, slowly, slowly, over the years, I started to feel I'm a global citizen. And from above, I looked down on Earth, on the conflict. And it's so easy to realize, to feel what is right, what is wrong. And I'm very careful to say here what is right, what is wrong, given, as an artist, I never believe in black or white. I believe in the shades of life. But as I write in the book, and if you may allow me, about there are a few things that cannot be justified in life, period. Okay? One of them is rape. Can you ever friend anyone who believes in rape? Hey, I raped a man or woman yesterday. Oh, cool. Great, man. Let's go have a drink. It's impossible. This is universal truth. It cannot be justified. One more thing that cannot be justified, in my opinion, is torture. You have a problem with someone, take that person to court. But to go torture people to get something out of them, for me, that is cannot be justified, period. A third thing that cannot be justified, and I hope you all agree on this, slavery. Can anyone friend anyone who believes he has a slave in the house? And my God, there are slaves all over this world. So I cannot, the ethics of that person are in question for me because there's something completely wrong in the way that person thinks. And another thing that cannot be justified is the occupation of people. How can, in the name of heavens, all over the world, justify the occupation of Palestine and Palestinians? Forget Palestine, Palestinians. Defend that brutal occupation of their body and their mind. So for me, anyone who justifies the occupation is like someone who justifies rape. End of the story. These things are black or white. That's the way I see it. We can speak about artistic things in the book.
Yes, more on the artistic things. Actually, it's a quote that you have in your book when you said, when you're talking about the image and the colonization of the image. And you wrote, I thought I had won my war with images by controlling it.
Yeah.
It turned out my control was an illusion. Yeah. I needed to locate that image, which had become a virus and extracted. Yes. Until then, my imagination would be colonized.
True. Yeah, because it's funny, when you live in London, why would I feel I'm under Israeli occupation? Is the physical occupation in front of me? It's not there, correct? I met once a woman in Dubai, and she has never been to Palestine, and yet she feels she lives under Israeli occupation. So I'm telling her, let's be clear about this, my dear. You are not living under Israeli occupation. So why do you feel you're under occupation? Because the mind is colonized itself. We live with the image of occupation in our mind. It's planted like a virus. The day you are born, injected in you, you'll always be under Israeli occupation as a Palestinian, regardless where you live. Now, that notion became very clear to me in London. And it's if I felt liberated, can you imagine the average person? And everyone thinks, oh my God, Steve always felt liberated. But it's not true. Even I fell victim to the image of occupation. And now, how do you get rid of this image? And this is where I wanted to bring back agency to the imagination. The power of the mind is free. There, I can construct any reality I want. Let's just put it this way. We all have the power to change the realities we live in. we create our own realities. Any structure we have created on this planet, we can de-structure it, unstructure it. I don't know what's the right word to use. It can be unstructured. But they tell you it's completely difficult. No, I don't think so. If we have created it, we can uncreate it. It's very simple. So I brought back more agency to my mind, to the imagination. If the occupation is an image, I'm going to create, confront it with another image that will liberate, you know, let them fight. I create image fight in my mind. And I really believed it. That's the whole thing. I had to believe my own reality and then defy it, shatter it, and then construct a new one. And this new one, I was born free. See it as a rebirth. It happened in November 2012, where I destroyed that image of occupation. I let the occupation sip drop by drop out of my veins. It's over. You know, the poison is out. And that's why I can speak out of my own experience and becoming, you will always become, we never are, a global citizen and look from above and say, you know what, I want to share my experience because it's not fair. If I felt liberated, then others should feel liberated. And the only way to do it is not by going and throwing rockets and killing and all this bullshit. Israelis and Palestinians both need to go in, maybe in such a process where the Israeli, him or herself, need also to free their minds from the image of the occupation. Because how can you be proud to be an Israeli while having this label attached to you wherever you are? It's a scar, it's a shame, especially knowing the history of Jews from, you know, a long time ago.
I would have a question, if it's possible.
Yes.
One moment. I mean, I sympathize very much with what you've said when you were talking about identity being something fluid, and you were trying to liberate yourself from this image of occupation.
Yeah.
Nevertheless, during the discussion, we have been very much hearing. I know it's a discussion, and you have to concise things, but we have been talking about the Israelis, the Palestinians, and the Orthodox Jews from here and the European Jews from there. So also using very many constructions or images, labels.
Yes, of course.
And therefore I'm asking myself, is not one of the major problems that because of the conflict and the context, the living context in that region, it is so highly politicized, and every word you're using, even if you're saying, I'm not saying I'm from East Jerusalem, I'm from Jerusalem, that already is a political statement. So isn't that really something trapping us when we are discussing also how you deal with the subject as an artist?
Yeah, I hear you. I mean, it's always a dilemma. We always fall in our own traps now. When I speak, given that we are here, I have to use certain terms to enable meaning. Otherwise, how I want me to refer at this moment to the dilemma? Just saying these people and those people and that people, it's problematic. I hear you, but I think there is not much to say because we have to enable some meaning as long as we remain true to what we want to achieve. And what I want to achieve, I think it's clear to everyone.
I mean, I totally agree with the question. I mean, there are some adjectives. It's about the danger of adjectives in terms of collective references. There's some adjectives like the Arab Jew, which I think are very important to use because the Arabness of
because
the Jew has been
denied.
Unlearned.
Yeah, because it's being denied.
Yeah,
yes,
it has been taken away.
Exactly,
it has been unlearned.
To be claimed back. And then
so,
deal with it. I hear you.
The people who came from Baghdad in the 50s, they were unlearning Arabic,
yes.
Like ideologically motivated. So I think, for example, to speak about the Arab Jew is an important thing, even
yes.
if it's a collective term. But otherwise, I agree very much, like George Saliba is a Lebanese historian of science. He's really talking about how dangerous all these collective adjectives are.
Yeah.
So if you avoid the adjectives, like all the adjectives, what remains, I tried it when I spoke. So what remains is actually a certain structure of thinking that comes along with the life of someone like you, with the artistic work. And that, I think, can be learned and transmitted, but it's very difficult. If you try to go without the adjectives,
yeah.
then the question is, what are you faithful to? If I am, say, I'm a Jewish intellectual, right, and I want to avoid the adjective Jewish because it's hijacked by the state, it is hijacked because it claims to be a Jewish state, which it is not. If I want to avoid that, I have to find a way, and that's very close to your question as an artist, how to remain faithful to a structure of thinking that has its own ways. It's an architecture of thinking. You can find it maybe in a rabbinic text, like in an old text, but then you really have to translate that way of thinking into your work. And you're doing it all
in
the time.
In my art.
Into your art.
Answer you.
And this is
in
very
my
interesting.
Art, I don't use
really.
Labels whatsoever. I dropped all texts from my work. In my last solos, I took even the name of the artwork. You see my point? Because I wanted people to project their own imagination into my work rather than construct one for them. So I had fights with the museum in Verona. I had an issue with the gallery in London. Why you want to drop what the work is about? I said, what the work is about is not up to me, it's up to the spectator, to the viewer. Now, it's easier to do this with visual arts, but when you expect to write with words, I need to use certain terms. I need to correct certain terms which I feel need to be corrected. For example, Jerusalem. The hell, since when did we agree that Jerusalem is east and west? Right? This is political propaganda by the Palestinian Authority and by Israel so that to divide the land into east and west. But you know, if you are from Jerusalem, you come from the whole world. It's one city. It should never be divided, in my opinion. And anyone who tried to divide the city, we saw what happened in it. All the empires vanished because this city has strength. It has power that defeats everyone. And the fact is, the people are fighting because Israelis want to insist on controlling it. And the more they control it, the more it fights back. You know, leave it alone, let Jerusalem develop its own identity, not force on it identity. Jerusalem cannot be only Jewish, it cannot be only Christian or Muslim or atheist, it is all of them and none of them at the same time. That's how I believe it, okay?
Beautiful.
I think you should read.
Okay, this is a little bit hardcore, but then there is this is my third reading, right? But then we go easy with the last one. But bear with me, please. After the failure of the second intifada, a period of uncertainty and stagnation set in. While Israelis fell more and more into their paranoia rooted in fear and justified their actions in the name of security, Palestinians plunged into deeper psychological defeat, into a state of numbness toward life under Israeli occupation. Palestinians reached a point where they can no longer, where they were no longer able to imagine they could live in freedom. The colonization on Palestinian land was obvious, but what was hidden was the colonization of their imagination. The more I lived under occupation, the more its effects sickened me. It made me question myself, forcing me to act, to play act, in order to survive. For many years, I ended up performing in scenes I didn't choose. Good actors lived a less humiliating life. Driving through checkpoints was an act. Only those who acted like Israelis passed without being stopped. Only Israelis had the balls to pass through military checkpoints without slowing down. I did the same. Shalom, the thought. They hardly had time to say even hello to me. I was rarely stopped. Trying to enter Israeli malls without looking Arab was an act. If caught, you would be stopped, searched, and have your ID number registered. Getting on an Israeli bus was an act. If noticed, you might risk getting spit at and harassed. And if you complained, you would get arrested just for being an Arab. I didn't want Cecile, my beautiful daughter sitting here, we left Jerusalem when she was 3, to have to act to live in her own city. In many years, we shielded her by leaving Jerusalem. This might have been an early start in her realization of the meaning of belonging and the suffering that comes from being uprooted. Leaving her birthplace might have been a necessary step in her feeling like a global citizen today. Shall I read one more passage or it's enough?
We have about 15 minutes, and there are surely more questions. Maybe we open some more questions. Yes.
I don't have a microphone.
Well, thank you very much for this wonderful insight to your work. I was wondering again if you can elaborate about the parachute metaphor, because I feel like parachute suggests that, like, I don't want to build any meaning into the world, but it feels like it suggests also a certain, to secure a free fall and not necessarily being only a weight or some kind of a control instrument. And for me, I was wondering if you can elaborate that. Why did you choose this word,
the parachute? I spoke about this in the beginning, but maybe I reiterate very quickly. I needed the illusion of freedom, where they tell you you are free, but you are not. You know, skydive, wow, amazing. But then you realize somebody's controlling your destiny. And I needed to I'm sure if there are Israelis around, you would know what I mean. Israel controls every aspect in Palestinian life. Nothing happens without Israeli. Okay, so how do I deal with this? I can unbuckle and take a leap of faith, but you, we all know what's going to happen. I'm going to die.
Crash.
I'm going to crash. It's impossible. And that's exactly the reality we live in. It's an impossible reality on the ground, period. Palestinians live in an atrocious, impossible reality, a loop. Never-ending loop. That's why I repeat a certain incident again and again. This loop must be broken. How do you break that loop? So I devised my own mechanism, and it's up to the Israeli and the Palestinian to invent, to imagine their own way out of a system that is really so controlling. It's so bad that probably, in my opinion, it's one of the worst systems that ever existed. Nobody speaks about it because nobody dares to speak about it. We're all afraid of Zionism, of Israel, of Jews, of all this, but nobody is saying something bad. All we want is to survive, to live. At the end of the day, I said, I don't want to kill anyone. I had a suicide vest in my parachute. Did I explode it? Of course not, because I want to live. And I'm sure the Israelis want to live. Who wants to die? Let's just put it this way, who wants to die? Unless you're really stupid, I mean.
And there is a very, very radical turn, twist of this parachute paradox in the end of the book, because then you actually do unbuckle.
Yes, I do.
And you do fall. And there is crash. The free fall, and there is the crush, and you are dying. Your protagonist is dying.
Truly.
And this is something I found sort of the very free moment. Also, the protagonist, Francesca, for example, is separate from the real lady life. Yeah, Francesca, it's very interesting how you, in the end, you convey exile and you convey the colonization and occupation onto your work, and you let the work go.
Yeah.
And you actually connect it to an economic question, which I find very interesting. You say, okay, I'm the artist, this is my work, I let go of it.
Yeah.
It carries the burden of exile, like in Yom Kippur, you send it to the Azazel, it carries the weight. And this is something really interesting because it translates also into an economic system, because you actually have an economic system around you. Yeah, you have your studio there, you have people who are, Amanda's here. I mean, there's a whole way you actually separate from your work in an economy that you yourself create.
Yes.
And this I find very interesting, because exile turns into an economic system in a way.
I resorted to art to liberate myself, and then I became hostage to art.
Yeah,
and
exactly.
Then, damn, I said, what is this?
This is what I
that
mean.
My process got contaminated, the art process. Right. And that process needed...
And you decided...
shatter it.
And so you shattered it by actually letting the artwork...
Has a life of its own.
In the market, in a way.
In
the market. In Dubai, in Doha, etc. And it's...
I divorced myself from my own narrative, because I realized the process that I used to liberate me became... I became hostage to that process.
Exactly.
So life itself is an endless process of liberation. There is no absolute freedom. Let me be clear about this. I'm sure I already trapped myself not being here. So now I have to do my homework, how to trap myself from this dilemma that happened tonight. But I wanted to say about one more thing. Why I, in that part, Francesca has become absent a little bit. Because on purpose, I take this protagonist out of the story. I take Francesca out of the story. Why? Because we can't wait for anyone to tell us we are free. It's impossible, the scenario. I mean, how atrocious that Palestinians became so naive without the F word. So naive. They're waiting for a freedom council called whatever it is, the UN, or Israel, or America, to tell them that they are free. November 15th, December 25th, Palestinians will be free. Are you kidding me? We're all born free. So if we have that feeling that we are free, liberating the land is 24 hours. But not one Palestinian, not, I don't want to say not one, sorry. many Palestinians don't feel that freedom. They don't have that mental freedom. And
I mean, you have the privilege, in a way, of leaving also. I mean, in a certain way, I'm saying it in a positive way, because then you can radicalize your own path. This is what I mean, because you know that there are children, I don't know, take a child drawing in Gaza. I mean, in Gaza, they draw zebra stripes on donkeys to create zoos with animals they don't have, or they don't see the sea, even if they live next to it. But still, you're driving it to the very, very, very edge of reclaiming this kind of liberation.
Because,
this is really the artistic side. Yeah. You ask about the artistic side of your work and the book. And the book is then an artwork. but Alya, are there more questions?
Please. Doro.
I know what the book is about, and I know how close it is to your heart and how important it is. But I'm a little surprised how little you addressed your artwork in tonight's conversation.
Yeah.
Because at the end of everything, you're an artist, and there's a moment of liberation you articulate in the book and in recent artworks where you come to terms with certain stages in your life.
Yeah.
And I was just wondering if that could somehow be included, because after all, this is a forum that...
I said we can move to this before, 15 minutes ago, but
we have
the
10 minutes left, and I just thought it's rather...
I want to answer this, but in a different way, quickly. When I did all these artworks, there were certain narratives that, you know, all changed from year to year, a little bit, you know, the way I looked at them, discovered new angles, new perspectives. It's inevitable that now maybe I speak about this layer in this book about Palestine, Israel. But trust me, in a year or 5 years, I will unveil so many other layers. And now this is the passion I want to work with. But you're correct. There are other many layers for this book. At this moment, I choose to speak about this because we need to speak about this. But let's go speak a little bit about...
Speak about your art.
Not about my art. Maybe... ask me a specific question about the writing or...
There is actually a part that has to do with the movement of liberation through the art and through the art market. And I would like to connect it with a text that you wrote actually a few years ago.
Okay.
About you as an artist and how you identify the two instances of recognition in the art world.
Yeah.
The market one and the institutional one. And I think it's an extremely, extremely smart way to like look at things from the distance, and how these two systems, which are very much, very often on a superficial way seen as two opposed systems, are actually very much intermingled. Can you tell a bit more about this and about your experience as an artist, where you need actually both system of recognition?
Yeah. I might have the book previous title, by the way, was called The Artist's Curse. Mm. And then I changed it to The Parachute Paradox just to narrow it. But my next book is called The Artist's Curse. So I'm going to speak about the art market and the artist and the art world in detail, because otherwise this would have been till here. Okay, so I said, let's cut it short. The idea of recognition is so problematic in the art world today. How do you validate who was an artist, who was not an artist? Why do we wait for the validation of the art market to tell us that this person is an artist? When I went to do my second master's at Sotheby's, day number one, if it's not sold, it's not art. Are you kidding me? I can create an artwork, and if nobody buys it, it doesn't exist. It's not an artwork. So from this point, I realized, wow, we also have a problem about my identity as an artist. Who says what I do is art or not? I needed also to liberate myself from this. Because if I choose to be an artist, it's my choice. I don't wait for you or for her or for the museum or for the collector to say, Steve is doing art. Again, we can't wait for the system to tell us we are free. It's the same concept. So that's why they are mirrored in my mind. It's very simple. As I said, again, you create your own reality. You choose what you want to be. And from there, we start. And the rest is inevitable. If you're creating good art, the system will have to find you. But we live in a constructed art world where it has taught us systematically, structurally, this needs to happen that you are this or you are that. Now, I'm defying all these notions. There are no fixed ways of working in the art world. I give an example. This 50% gallery artist, as if it's written on biblical stone. I once had a discussion with the Berlin Southern Gallery and Circle Avenue in Berlin about this invisible catalog. I said, is it written somewhere as a protocol that this has to be like this? Of course not. So why we all assume that this is the structure? There can be other structures we can work with. And I'm an artist who believes in synergy. That's why maybe when I met Shulami the first time, I was mesmerized by her presence because she and me realized, and you, by the way, the same story. We can work together because there is something beyond art, beyond me and you, that we can leave for people to look at for history, for the society. But most museums, institutions, and galleries, and artists, their ego does not allow them to go beyond the first step. Thinking, I'm a very daring artist. Birte, the publisher is here, when I had my first meeting with her. I'm a very daring artist, but why not? I mean, if Birte, the publisher, would have said no to this book, we would not be here today, well, correct?
Yeah, definitely.
So, thank you very much. Yeah, we have to be on the
and
same
also
page.
The question of the art, why the art is not so much a topic tonight. It is because I treat this as an artwork. It is an artwork. I mean, the book in a certain way is in itself a piece of art because it is written by you as an author.
Which I do see it as an artwork.
Yes, so this is why we talk about the book. And in the book, obviously, the Jerusalemite story and the story about the hijacking of the imagination by the political disaster is a theme. So this is why we speak about it. So, because it's not about your artwork in the visual art. It's about how it's entangled in the political story. It's entangled, and I want to read just one little passage, how it's sort of being disentangled by you, and then you have your... final passage, and there is a welcome. There is a reception upstairs due to the generosity of ICI. You are all invited. There's wine, etc. And also, there you will sign some of the books. So there's a personal book signing also. But here, when you go to the old city in your own house and you reclaim the layers of the walls. I'm just reading this, how it felt to you. I mean, this is why we talked all the evening about the psyche of the situation living under occupation. I started peeling and noted how the process resembled the peeling of an onion, removing layers and layers until there was nothing. I was aware of this being my last chance to dig directly into my wound, search for the source of my pain, and extract it. The pain. I was consciously projecting my past into each fragment, and the act of peeling got rid of the toxic residue I had been carrying with me for years. I handed each piece I removed to Christa, who laid them on the floor. Standing at the top of the ladder, the distance between me, the fragments, and the history I embedded in them grew. I was letting go. Now the fragments carried my burden for me. It's like the Azazel. I could finally let go of the stones on my back.
Yes, true.
So this is why I think we talked the evening exactly on the point, because we talked about this book. And this book is about living in Jerusalem under the conditions that you describe. So this is, for me, a very key passage.
It's a nice passage.
You.
I know that. I read it from you.
And you, now yours, maybe.
I will read just this very short, 4 paragraphs. When my fragment, one of the fragments I created, shattered in London, just fell on the underground and disappeared, like became like dust again. You know, and I was, again, it was my fight with the image. I thought I won my war with the image. To realize that the image is way stronger than me. Who am I? I realized that my task is atrocious. When my fragment shattered in the London Underground, I realized I had been stripped of the only thing I thought was under my control, my imagination. As long as I didn't resolve my paradox with the Israeli occupation, the virus would become more toxic. Its residue would continue to suffocate me. I needed to release myself from the Israeli on my back. And I knew the price would be my life. Either I would surrender to the Israeli above me, submitting to the reality of being born under eternal occupation, or I would unbuckle myself to take a leap of faith, since surrender was not in my nature. My fate was sealed. All I could do was hope that after the impact, I would have a bit of power left to survive. I sat down and sifted through each and every page in the file of my past. When I was done, I stitched my wounds with barbed wire. In a few months, all my poison dripped out of my body. I came to terms with my history. I found a life between euphoria and melancholia, between exile and home. I'm the only one who can be the source of my energy. As a child, I pointed a flashlight into the well of my old city house. Today, I look into the dark well of my life and see my own light mirrored back. Every time I fall into the darkness, my darkness, I remind myself that liberation comes through the search for inner light. I said this, but sorry, I said it again. Maybe it's important, because this is really a key point. In the struggle of the Palestinian people has shifted from one of liberating the land to one of liberating the self. Freedom is universal truth. We are all born free. No freedom council like the UN or governing bodies like the EU or governments like that of the United States, and definitely not of Israel, get to decide who is free or not, for the love of God. Palestinians should stop waiting for arbitrarily set dates to obtain their individual independence. Independence Day is today, and everyone should declare it. I've been having many conversations with people lately about the strongest verb I know. The strongest word I know. And guess what it is? When Cecile and I talk, we often start our thoughts with imagine. 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 For many years, my life was held hostage by Israeli occupation. But in my dreams, I was free. Once I learned how to change my own consciousness, my dreams became my reality. I was born under Israeli occupation, but found a way to live free. As for liberating the land of Palestine, I leave it to our collective imagination. Now I can do my thanks. I have to do my thanks because it's very important for me. It's not out of... I would like to thank all of you who came today to take the time at a time when nobody comes to anything anymore in life. Thank you to ICI Berlin for hosting this event, the ICI director, Christoph Holtze, Claudia Peppel, and the entire ICI team. Thank you for joining. I am very much happy that you're present in my life, and I think we can stream a lot of things in life. Alya, truly thanks for being here. Always great talks, and Alya and me spoke about the process of stitching wounds long time ago over absence, sorry. Nadia Kabalan for the film, she's present here. Definitely I would like to thank Amanda, my studio manager, for being with me through this atrocious process. I mean, she could have left many times, and ironically she's my third studio manager, or the first one immigrated to Australia, and she's leaving to Australia in 3 months. It seems if you're you have to immigrate to Australia. Irrepressible, so if you know anyone who can become my studio manager, please. But very hard to fit her shoes. Birte, great, really, again, thank you very much for seeing the bigger picture. And of course, everyone at Kerber Verlag for doing a beautiful book. Verena, for the design, thank you very much. When you came to the studio, very passionate, and what I liked about you, your sense of justice, because you also realize what's happening there is cannot happen. I would like to thank the supporters of my book. Speaking of freedom, I cannot wait for institutional money. I applied for every damn grant on the planet. Nobody gives a damn about you as an artist. They don't. So I changed my strategy. I called my collectors, said, listen, I need to work. I need 5,000 euro. I need to work 6 months. So each one shipped, I don't know how much, and then it turned out it's five, because it took 3 years. So Amir Hanedi, Cap Kuwait, thank you very much. Kenneth Anderson and Adrian Vachon. Marco Sasson from my great gallery and friend in Italy. And of course, there is a person that I can always thank again and again, the visionary support of Margherita Berloni, who is really a superpower. And of course, Francesca, the woman of my life, and the greatest daughter on earth, Cecile. Thank you very much, all.